Okay, good. So good morning, everyone. We are now recording the lecture. Right, so a quick recap of yesterday. The most important thing we did yesterday is the following. We proved that if you have any two edge connected graph, H, and you add an ear to it, Q, and you get a new graph, G is equal to H plus Q. Right, so that is your new graph. H is the old graph. Right? Then the new graph is also going to be two edge connected. Okay? And adding an ear, I showed you by pictures, but I did not write down a formal definition. Hopefully the pictures were clear enough. But today I decided to put down a formal definition just for the sake of completeness. So what does it mean to add a Q, add an ear to a graph H? It means that Q is going to be a path of the new graph with both ends in the vertices of H. So in this case, the ends are U and V. So U and V are in H, but everything else is going to be disjoint with H, right? So everything else is actually new. So this drawing is illustrative enough, I hope. Or the other possibility is that you add a cycle. And in this case, exactly one vertex of the cycle has to be in H. So in this case, V of Q intersection V of H is the vertex W. Okay? In the drawing I have made. Another way to think of it is it's like adding a path except that U is equal to V. Okay? So it's like a path but U is equal to V. Right? So it's not a path actually. Okay. So these are the two ways you can add an ear. And this is what we will refer to as adding an ear to a graph, right? Okay, so are there any questions regarding how we prove this? Is everybody convinced that this statement is true?
Yeah, convinced, I guess.
Yes? Okay, thanks Dave. Good. So if there are any questions regarding yesterday's lecture, just interrupt me. Or we can start with the new stuff today. So now the goal is to prove the converse. So in some sense, we are going to prove the reverse direction. What does this mean? We are going to show, so this is saying that if you keep doing this procedure, you will be able to construct two edge connected graphs. What we now want to prove is that every two edge connected graph can be constructed by this procedure. Okay. Every two edge connected graph can be built using this procedure. What is the procedure? Ear decomposition, right? You can also think of it as a procedure or as a decomposition of the graph. Okay. Okay. So how do we go about this? So let me ask you a simple question. And this time I'm actually going to call out the name because the question is easy enough. I want there to be participation from everybody. So I'm going to call out a name. So, Bola Venkata Pavan, are you here?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, Venkata, does every two edge connected graph have a cycle?
Yes, sir.
Right, okay. So, we know, supposing we have a two edge connected graph, let's say G is a two edge connected graph. Okay. So, we know that G has a cycle. Okay. Anthony, are you there, Anthony? Harshit, are you there?
Yes, sir.
So how do you find a cycle?
Can I have a traversal and find a, see if you come back at a visited vertex.
I see. Okay. Right. So that is one way to do it. You keep making a path and eventually come back to that vertex. But what if that vertex is not in the cycle?
Then try from some other vertex.
Okay. Is there any more direct way to find a cycle? Supposing I give you a spanning tree. Now, how would you find a cycle?
If you add more edges which are not already present in the spanning tree.
Exactly.
They construct the cycle.
Exactly. So you take any spanning tree and add an edge and you will actually get a unique cycle. So I want everybody to think about this. Spanning tree. So we are assuming that the graph is connected, right? That is not an issue. Spanning tree plus edge contains a unique cycle. Of course, we don't care so much about uniqueness, but actually it makes it easier to find the cycle. So I want everybody to think about this and convince yourself, right? This is a basic graph theory fact. And if you're not, then we can discuss it. Okay. So this is one way to find a cycle. So we can easily find a cycle. Now let's suppose we found the cycle. Okay. So this is our cycle in the graph G. C is a cycle in G. Okay. But I want to make an ear decomposition, right? So I'm going to start with the cycle, but I want to now keep adding ears and construct the graph G. So there are two possibilities at least. One possibility is that all the vertices of the graph are already in this cycle. So one case is that V of G is equal to V of C. Okay. And another possibility is that V of C is a proper subset of V of G. So proper subset means it is not equal to, but it is of course contained in the vertices of G, right? Good. So what do we do in this case? Supposing we are in this case, how can we now construct an ear decomposition of G from starting from this cycle? Anyone? How would we now construct a decomposition, an ear decomposition of G from this cycle?
Sure, because now all the edges will between any of these vertices which are already there in the cycle. Whenever you put an edge, it will always be a part of the cycle. So you are anyway constructing an ear decomposition out of it, right?
That's right. That's right. Thanks. Was that Dave?
Yes, yes.
Okay, thanks. For some reason, I wasn't able to see who was speaking. Okay. Exactly. So that's actually how you do it. You already have covered all the vertices. Now you can add the edges in any order you like, and that's an ear decomposition, right? So if the graph has more edges, you just add them in any order you like, and each time you're adding an ear to the graph. Okay. So that's quite straightforward. Just add edges which are off in the graph but are not in the cycle in any order. For example, if there are four edges, E1, E2, E3, E4, like I've drawn, then your ear decomposition will be C, E1, E2, E3, E4. Actually, no. The ear decomposition is a sequence of subgraphs. That will be C, C plus E1, C plus E1 plus E2, and so on, up to C plus E1 plus all the way up to E4, right? So your first graph would be the C, the cycle, then you take this edge E1, then you take one more edge and you keep adding them in any order, and that is your ear decomposition. Okay? And because the graph has an ear decomposition, it means the graph is two edge connected, right? Because of what we already proved. Because we started with a two edge connected graph, the cycle, and we kept adding ears, so the resulting graph will be two edge connected. And actually, if you think about it, all of the graphs in the sequence, all of the graphs in the sequence are two edge connected, all subgraphs, right? So they are subgraphs of the big graph G. All subgraphs of G are two edge connected. What I mean is, all of these subgraphs are two edge connected. And therefore, the final graph is also two edge connected. Right? So now let's look at the second case. So you have a cycle, but now the graph has more vertices. So these are the vertices of the graph that are not in the cycle. And this is non-empty. This is not equal to the empty set. So now can anyone tell me how you would find an ear to add to this graph? Tarun Kumar, can you explain what you just wrote? Oh, mic is not working. All right, so I will read out what he wrote. Mark vertices of the current cycle is visited. Choose a vertex which is on the cycle and has an unvisited edge. Do DFS with such a vertex as start until we reach a vertex which is visited. That's right. So that is essentially the correct answer. Let me explain it slightly differently. So what Tarun is saying is that because this is a connected graph, there has to be some edge from the cycle that goes into the other side. Right? Because this is a connected graph, there has to exist, there exists an edge E from the vertices of the cycle to the vertices of the graph minus the vertices of the cycle. Okay? This is a basic graph theory, right? The graph is connected, so there has to be some edge like this. Now what he's saying is, now you can do a DFS. Now this is a part where I would like someone to elaborate further. So I want you to use the two edge connectivity. So can you now use the two edge connectivity? Can you use the two edge connectivity property to complete the argument? Can somebody complete the argument from this point? I don't want to use DFS. I want to use something else. Yeah.
So since E cannot be a cut edge, it must be part of a cycle. And okay. Since one edge of E is on the original cycle C, that means the rest of the cycle must also come back to C at some point.
Okay. So that is one way to complete it. So what Samuel is saying is that E is not a cut edge. So E has to be in a cycle, right? It has to be in a cycle. And so what does that cycle look like? Well, think of the cycle as you traverse the cycle from here. So what's going to happen? At some point, the cycle has to come back into this part because it needs to go back to this vertex, right? It doesn't have to come to this vertex. It could go to any vertex, for example. Right? And when the cycle hits back, this cycle Q, which contains the edge E, hits the original cycle C, you stop there. And you call this part the path P. And you add this P to the cycle C, and that is an ear, right? So that is one way to do it. Okay? Right? Another way to think about the same thing is you can delete the edge E. So you can call the ends of E, let's say S and T. And now what you can say is that G minus E is connected because the graph is two edge connected, which means there exists a path Q from T to the vertices of C in G minus E. So you delete the edge, you think that the edge E has been removed. And now because the graph is connected, because the original graph was two edge connected, now there has to be a path from T back to this set, back to the vertex set of C. And this can be your P, and now Q can be E plus P. So you add the ear, the edge plus the path you found, right? So there are many ways to complete this argument, right? You can take a cycle. Another way to complete it is, as Samuel said, or consider a cycle containing E and use this to find the ear. Okay? And probably there are some other ways to think about it, right? Okay. So in this manner, notice that this path could start at the vertex T and could go back to the vertex S, right? In this case, you will get the ear of second type, this type of ear, where the ear is a cycle, right? Or you could find the ear of the first type. Just to be clear, we will come to this later. This is called an open ear. Yeah, maybe I should have explained this first. This is called an open ear. And this is called a closed ear. Okay. So using this procedure, you can find either an open ear or a closed ear. Right? Okay, good. So you find an ear, you add it to the graph. So now you get a new graph. Now you get the graph C plus 1 year Q. Let's call this Q1. Okay. Now, how would I find the second year? Anybody? Can anyone tell me how I'll find the second year now?
Again, if you have not,
okay.
Yeah, if you have not exhausted all the vertices, there must be some vertex with an edge which is not belongs to C plus Q1. Take that and remove that
from
the processor again.
Exactly. Thanks, Nasima. So right, so you do the same procedure, right? It's the same step now. The fact that the original graph was a cycle is actually not important at all. The original graph was two edge connected, so here in our argument, we did not need C to be a cycle. It could have been any two edge connected subgraph of the original graph G. Right? So you can do the same argument here. If this is all the vertices, then you keep adding the remaining edges. If this is not all the vertices, then there are some other vertices in the graph. You find a path, you find an edge going out because the graph is connected. Then you remove the edge and then you find a path going back to the original subgraph. And you take this E plus P to be your Q, right? It is the same thing. So does everybody see why this is an algorithm? Do you see that this is actually an algorithm? It is not just an existential proof. We are actually discussing how you can find the ear.
Yes.
Right? We actually have an algorithm to construct an ear decomposition. We have an algorithm to construct any air decomposition. Okay, how does this algorithm work? I'm going to write it very briefly. And notice one thing I want to make very clear. Actually, let me first write down the algorithm, then I'll discuss this point. So what is the algorithm? So you have, what is the input? The input is a connected graph, right? We will assume the graph is connected. We can also just check that using a standard BFS-DFS algorithm. But let's assume the graph is connected, right? We want to check if the graph is two-edge connected. So first we find a cycle. If there is no cycle, so in other words, what you could do is you could first take a spanning tree. And if there are no more edges, then the whole graph is a tree. And this graph is not two-edge connected, right? So that is one way to do it. If there does not exist a cycle, then graph is not two-edge connected. Okay. What would be a certificate? Can anybody tell me what is a certificate that the graph is not two-edge connected? Sefali, can you suggest to me what is a certificate that the graph is not two-edge connected?
Not two-edge connected, cut edge.
Exactly, right? So what is a cut edge in this example? Supposing your graph is a tree, then what is a cut edge?
You can pick out any edge you want.
Any edge is a cut edge. Any edge is a cut edge, right? So you can return any edge, and that is a certificate that the graph is not two-edge connected. Okay, good. Okay, so now let's suppose we found a cycle. Find a cycle C, okay? So now we have a cycle C. Now what do we do? Actually, now I'm going to write a loop. Okay, now I'm going to write a loop. Let H equal to C. Okay? And until the vertices of H is a proper subset of vertices of G, we are going to do some steps. So we are going to take this two-edge connected graph, which could be the cycle, or it could be already, we could be in some other step of the algorithm, right? We could be in a future step of the algorithm, right? So we take this subgraph, we call it H, and if the vertices of H are not all the vertices of G, if these are not equal sets, then what do? We first find an edge E equal to UV such that U is in H and V is not in H. Right? So this is my edge UV. We find this kind of edge in the drawing, in the graph. So think of this as your H. Okay? We find such an edge. Then what do? In G minus E, we find a path P from V to the vertices of H. Okay? So technically what could happen is you could find a long path. It could be something like this, right? But what I'm going to do is I'm going to stop the path as soon as it comes to the first vertex, right? I'm going to remove the unnecessary part. Okay? So I will not write down this detail. It is written in my type notes, right? So I'm going to assume that P is a path from V to the vertices of H. Okay. And P intersect VH is exactly 1, right? If the path is longer, then I'm just going to cut it. I'm just going to remove this part. Okay. Good. And now what do? Can anybody tell me what is the next step? We are in a loop. We need to update something.
e plus p is the year, so we update h by adding e plus p.
Right. So let's put q equal to p plus e and h equal to the old h plus q. Right? Okay. And now we are in a loop, so we will go back to the step and we will keep doing this. When does this loop end? When does this loop end?
When we have all the vertices from G.
Right. Exactly. So that step three, what has happened is this condition is no longer true, which means that the vertices of H is equal to the vertices of G. Right. And at this step, what do we do? Bharadwaj, are you there?
Yes, sir.
What do we do at this step? Anybody else? What do we do at this step?
Sir, you add the remaining edges with both ends of the vertices in H itself.
Exactly. Add the remaining edges in any order. In any order. Right? Good. And this is it. So what happened? There is some problem with this algorithm. Can somebody tell me what is the problem with this algorithm? This algorithm seems to suggest that the graph is always two-edge connected. Have we made some mistake?
In 2.2, shouldn't we also check that if the path P exists?
In 2.2, we should check whether the path exists. Right. So what we assume that we can find a path. So we should also put a clause here. If such a path does not exist, then what do we do? What if such a path does not exist?
Then we have to output the graph is not two connected.
The graph is not two edge connected. Then G is not two edge connected. What is the cut edge in this case?
E.
What is the cut edge? E. Return the cut edge E. Return false and return the cut edge E. I'm not writing the algorithm completely precisely here. It will be in the type notes. Don't worry about it. Right? So there are at least some places where we are returning. Okay, what about step 2.1? Will there always be an edge going from H to the remaining vertices? What about 2.1? Can we go wrong in 2.1?
No, because we assume that it is a connected graph.
That's right. We assume that the graph is connected, so we cannot go wrong in this step. Right? So the only place where the algorithm can fail, the algorithm doesn't actually fail. The algorithm just finds a cut edge and tells you that the graph is not two edge connected. Right? And if this does not happen, so there are two places where this could have happened. The first place is when the graph is just a tree and we don't find any cycle. Right? So you can return any cut edge. Right? So in this case, the algorithm returns false. Or no, maybe I should not say false. I should say no. In 2.2, the algorithm can return no in this case. Otherwise, you go through the whole algorithm and you return yes. The graph is two edge connected. Yes, G is two edge connected. And what is the certificate? What is the certificate that the graph is two edge connected?
The edge E that we returned and 2.2 that failed.
That would be the certificate for the graph to not be two edge connected. I'm looking for the certificate for the graph to be two edge connected.
The C edge that we generated.
What is
ear decomposition that we have taken.
Right, the ear decomposition. So we will also return the ear decomposition. Right? So in the algorithm, you need to keep track of the ear decomposition. So in the actual algorithm, you also need to have one more thing, something like, I think I call it in my notes, a script D. So this will be an ear decomposition. So what will it look like? The ear decomposition script D will look like, you start with the cycle, then you get the first H, H1, then you get H2, and so on. And you finally get a last graph, which is equal to G. Okay. So in my notes, I actually call this G0, G1, G2, up to GR. Okay. And G0 is a cycle, and GR is equal to G. And each GI is obtained from GI minus 1 by adding an ear. Right? So during the algorithm, you keep track of all the ears you are adding, and at the end of the algorithm, you return the whole ear decomposition. Right? And that is a certificate that the graph is two-edge connected. So our decision problem is in P, and it is also in NP because, well, P is a subset of NP. That is one way to think about it. But we also have a very, very elegant certificate for a graph to be two-edge connected. And that certificate is called an ear decomposition of the graph, right? And so that was our goal, if you recall from our last lecture. Right? We wanted to find an elegant certificate. And in this sense, ear decomposition is an NP certificate for two-edge connected graphs. Ear decompositions are an NP certificate for two-edge connectivity. Okay. All right. So this algorithm that we just wrote down, can be converted into a proof. And I actually want to spend a few minutes to do that. Because I want you to view, the proof and algorithm as something different. The proof and the algorithm are actually two sides of the same coin. What we just did, we essentially proved that any two-edge connected graph has an ear decomposition. And the way we did it is we gave an algorithm that will find the ear decomposition, right? But I also want you to learn in this course how to write a proof that is not necessarily completely dependent on the algorithm, or in some sense, there is a more abstract way of thinking about the algorithm that will give you the proof for why an ear decomposition exists for any two-edge connected graph. Okay? And I want to spend probably the remaining lecture on how to convert this algorithm into a proof, right? So the rest of the lecture, I want to convert the above algorithm into a proof. Okay? And why are we doing this? One of the goals of this course is also for you to be able to read papers in this area of research. Right? And a lot of papers are not written algorithmically. They are written from a more graph theoretical point of view. But the point is that these are not separate things. You can actually extract the algorithm from the graph theoretic explanation in many cases. And that's something I want you to be able to do at the end of this course. And during the course, I want you to learn this. Right? So what we are going to prove now is the following theorem. Let G be a two-edge connected graph. then G admits an ear decomposition. Okay? And okay, how do we prove this? I want to make the statement that in some sense, we have already proved it. From an algorithmic point of view. Right? But I want to write a different proof. And you will see that this proof is much shorter, actually. It is the same proof, but the way you write it, it turns out to be a lot shorter. And it is a bit of an art to be able to read such proofs and to be able to learn how to write them, right? And that is something I want you to also get from this course, okay? So how would we prove such a statement? Supposing our graph is just a cycle, right? If our graph is just a cycle, then we are done. So let's suppose it is not a cycle. And let's suppose we are able to add some years. We start from a cycle and we keep adding some years. And let's say at some point, we are not able to add years anymore. That would be a contradiction, right? That would mean that there is some problem. We are not able to prove the statement. So that is the idea we are going to take. What we are going to do is, we are going to start from a subgraph of the graph, which admits an ear decomposition. If this graph is the whole graph, then the proof is done. Then there is nothing to prove. So let's suppose this graph is not the whole graph. Then we need to arrive at some contradiction. So it is going to be a proof by contradiction, okay? And it is actually the same as the algorithm, but it's a different way of thinking about it. Okay, so since G is two edge connected, G has a cycle by the corollary that we discussed in the last lecture. Okay, so there is a cycle, say C. Okay, so C is some cycle of the graph. In this proof, we will not discuss how to find the cycle, right? This is just to prove that an ear decomposition exists. Okay? So there is a cycle, right? Now, a cycle is a two-edge connected graph, and a cycle admits an ear decomposition. What I'm going to do is, I'm going to take a maximal. So this is a word that is really important. And I will discuss a bit more. Let H be a maximal two edge connected subgraph of G that admits an ear decomposition. Okay, I will explain what all of this means in case it's not clear. Okay, note that C is two edge connected and it admits an ear decomposition, right? This is trivial. A cycle is two edge connected. We have already discussed that. And what is an ear decomposition of a cycle? Can anybody tell me what is an ear decomposition for a cycle? If I give you just a cycle, the cycle graph C, what is the ear decomposition of this cycle?
The cycle itself,
right? The cycle itself is an ear decomposition. It is exactly one, an ear decomposition is a sequence. In this sequence, there is exactly one element, the cycle, right? So the cycle is a two-edge connected subgraph of the original graph, and it admits an ear decomposition. So what we can now do is we can try to take as big such a subgraph as possible. So what maximal means, is that no bigger subgraph, what do I mean by bigger? Let me see. What maximal means is you cannot add more things to H to construct another subgraph with the same property. Let me actually give you an example. The example will not be two-edge connected because otherwise you will have a contradiction. So let's think about this graph. Can anybody tell me what is a maximal subgraph? Actually, yeah, let me make it more interesting. Can anybody tell me what is a maximal subgraph in this graph that admits a E-R decomposition? This graph is not two-edge connected. What I'm looking for is a subgraph of this graph, which is two-edge connected, and therefore it admits an E-R decomposition. Can anybody give me an example?
Yeah, there are two. One of them is the loop 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1.
Right, okay. So one of them, can you give me the other one? Can you give me the more interesting one?
Yeah, the subgraph 6, the triangle and square at the right side.
The triangle and square on the right side. Yes. So, okay. Where did I come here? Oh, I see. Somehow things changed. Okay. 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 Good. So now, so let's just look at the triangle. Let's just look at the triangle first. This is not maximal. This is not a maximal two-edge connected subgraph because you can add more things to it and get a two-edge connected subgraph, okay? But now this thing is maximal because now there is nothing in the graph that you can add to make a two-edge connected subgraph, okay? Because if you add anything, you will get a cut edge, 5, 6, okay? Or you will get a disconnected graph. If you add something like this, then you will get a disconnected graph. So that is not valid. So maximal means something with the same property, something with a certain property, but you cannot make it bigger. And it is very useful to get proofs by contradiction. Okay? And I'm emphasizing this because I know that some of you may not be very familiar with writing formal proofs. So those of you who are familiar, good. But those of you who are not, I'm just trying to explain what the point of taking a maximal subgraph is. Are there any questions? This is really crucial. Are there any questions?
Can you explain the maximal part again? Because I couldn't understand.
Okay, right. So to go back to that point. So in this example that we just did, right? Let me just redraw the example and make it a bit more interesting. Okay, so what I want to do is, notice that this graph is not two-edge connected, but this is a two-edge connected subgraph. Okay, the red colored stuff. And let me erase the other red colored part. Okay, this is a two-edge connected subgraph, what I have drawn in red, the triangle. But this is not maximal, because I can make a bigger two-edge connected subgraph by adding more things to it. So what will I add to it? For example, I can add this green colored path. Is this maximal? Is this a maximal red plus green? Is it a maximal two-edge connected subgraph? Sefali? This red colored per green plus green color, do you think this is a maximal two-edge connected subgraph? Or can I add more things to it to make it two-edge connected, to keep the two-edge connected property?
More can be added, I
okay,
think.
What can I add? What can I add?
If we add zero or something.
Yes,
there.
Zero, yeah. Zero.
Zero and four.
Zero and four. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Now is it maximal or can I add more things to it? What about the vertex 5? Can you somehow include the vertex 5?
Yeah, 0 and 5, and then 4 and 5 can
exactly,
be connected.
Exactly. You can add the ear 0 to 5 to 4, and you have the bigger 2-edge connected subgraph. Right? But right. Now can you make it bigger? Now can you make this 2-edge connected subgraph bigger so that the resulting graph is still 2-edge connected?
No, it's sufficient.
Exactly. This is it, right? Now you cannot do anything more. So in this case, the red plus the green plus the blue stuff is a maximal 2-edge connected subgraph. Yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So is the maximal property clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Another thing I want to also emphasize is maximal and maximum are different. For example, in this graph, you can say, what is maximal? Well, there are two maximal 2-edge connected subgraphs, the triangle and the blue colored quadrilateral, the 4-cycle, right? They are both maximal 2-edge connected subgraphs, but one of them is bigger than the other. So one of them you can say is maximum. So maximum is not the same as maximal, right? This is a distinction. This you can say is a maximum in the sense that it is the biggest 2-edge connected subgraph. But both of these are maximal, right? So often in doing mathematics, CS theory, you will see the word maximal and maximum used. And it is important to keep the distinction. Maximal just means that you cannot make this bigger by adding more things to it and preserving the property you are interested in. Maximum means you look at all the maximal ones and choose the one which is biggest. Okay? So just keep in mind, maximal is not the same as maximum. Not the same. Okay? But anyways, we don't need the concept of maximum here. So let's... Does anybody else have any questions about the discussion we just had? Anybody?
Okay. Yeah, it's fine.
Okay. So, okay, we have already crossed the time. It is 8:51. So what we will do is we will continue this proof tomorrow. But what I want you all to do is I want you all to think of how you will complete the proof, this proof. Think of how you can complete this proof yourself. But don't worry, we will complete it tomorrow. And after that, we will switch to vertex connectivity. Actually, we may not immediately switch. We may have to talk a little bit more about edge connectivity. Okay? So that is all for today. And we will complete this proof tomorrow. And we will move on to vertex connectivity at some point tomorrow. And if there are any questions, then please stay back. And I'm here to answer them. Thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, during the discussion, you said that if the graph is the cycle graph and it is the whole graph, cycle graph mm-hmm. is the whole graph, then the ER decomposition is the graph itself, that cycle.
Yeah.
But for ER decomposition, don't we need some other vertex which is not in the graph already?
Right. So that's the definition of ER decomposition. So an ER decomposition is a sequence of subgraphs, right? So I never wrote down the formal definition completely. Maybe I'm going to write it tomorrow. Maybe you know what, I will just... Right, so I'll just try to explain to you without writing it right now. I don't want to make the notes more cluttered. So what is an ER decomposition? It is a sequence of subgraphs. So an ER decomposition of a graph G is a sequence of subgraphs G0, G1, G2, up to GR. where g0 is a cycle of the graph. The last graph gr is equal to the graph g, and every gi is obtained from the previous gi minus 1 by adding an ear. Now, what is possible is that r is equal to 0. So when r is equal to 0, that means that you basically, your sequence is just one graph and you don't add any ears actually. So it is a sort of a trivial ear decomposition. It is a very uninteresting ear decomposition. It is like the Bayes case in some sense, right?
Okay.
Ear decomposition, you will add some ears. But in this case, because the graph is just a cycle, you have the special case that r is equal to 0 and your sequence is just one graph, g0. And that is the cycle, that is the whole graph.
Okay, so ER is different and ER decomposition is different. Decomposition exists only if there is a ER.
That would make sense intuitively. That's right. That's slightly comical, let's say.
Okay.
So an ER decomposition is a sequence, and in that sequence, all the elements after the first, I mean, it's tricky, right? You can also think of the cycle itself as an ear. You can think of the cycle itself as being added to the empty graph. And you can think of the cycle itself being an ear.
Okay.
Right? Because there are two types of ears. One ear is a path and the other ear is a cycle, right? Like this. This is a open ear and this is a closed ear. Right, so you can think of the cycle itself being added to the empty graph, the graph with zero vertices, as a closed ear. So that is one way to reconcile this this sort of contradiction. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thanks. Any other questions? Are there any other questions?
No, sir. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Thank you. Vamsi, Krishna, Valluru, you have any questions? Okay, I'm going to stop the recording.